Hello and welcome. I hope you guys didn't get bored by the last repair video, but I was kind of in repair mood and decided to make another one. Here I have one very nice 486 mainboard. It was made by FIC, is named 486PIO3. As you already can see, it is one very late 486 board with PCI slots and integrated I/O controller for the drive, serial ports, etc. An unusual feature of this board is that it supports up to 1 MB of level 2 cache, however, there are currently only 256 KB installed. And since it is a very late 486 board, as I already said, it has to support 3-volt CPUs, which is confirmed by the presence of this voltage regulator down here. This board is mostly working, but there is one problem with it, so let me show what it is. This is an Intel 486 Dx266 CPU, a very common and widely used CPU back in the days, but is also very appreciated by the retro community today. The CPU defined the top development point in the 486 era. There were faster 486 CPUs made after this one, but they all coexisted with Pentium, which at that time already hit the market. So all the 486 models suddenly became more like a low-level segment CPUs. That's a funny fact, because despite that, for example, DX4100 is a lot faster CPU, it is often considered low-end, where the DX266 is a high-end CPU. This is due to the point in time where they were produced. Anyway, I added some memory and a post card already. Let's start the system. As you hopefully can see, some numbers on the post card are running and we are getting some beep codes about a missing graphics card. This combination seems to work just fine. This 486 DX266 CPU, which I am using here, is a 5-volt CPU and is powered directly by the power supply. This voltage regulator is not involved because it is only required for 3-volt CPUs. There are these two jumpers, which have to be pulled off to allow the voltage regulator to take over the voltage supply to the CPU. And there are another two jumpers here, which can be used to select between 3.3 volts and 4 volts in multiple steps. So, this 486 DX266, which is currently in the board, needs 5 volts and will not boot if I will try to run it with 3 volts. Therefore, I will need another CPU. For example, this AMD AM486 DX280. Which requires 3 volts to run properly. But I will not put it into the socket, because I already know that it will not work in there. And I would like not to damage the CPU. Let's take a look, why exactly will it not work? I switched the jumpers and we should now get something around 3.3 volts. The datasheet for the CPU says that one of the VCC pins is E2, the fifth pin on the second row. This datasheet represents a view on the pins, so I have to mirror the layout when searching the appropriate pin on the socket. I will use such a short copper wire with open ends to measure the voltage applied to the CPU. Yeah, as you see, we are getting only around 80 millivolts. That can be considered zero. Now, without turning off the power, let me switch the jumpers back to 5 volts again. And we are getting 5 volts indeed. Now the big capacitor left from the voltage regulator should be charged. And look what happens when I switch the jumpers back to 3 volts and instantly measure the voltage on the CPU. As you can see, it constantly drops toward 0 volts. But what happens there? As I said, the capacitor was charged to 5 volts, and as I switched the jumper, the capacitor started to discharge slowly, and this was what I just measured here. So, obviously the capacitor doesn't get recharged, but why? I called this part a voltage regulator until now. However, this is actually a power transistor, and it is one of the parts which are responsible for charging the capacitor. Obviously, this seems somehow not to work at all, and to be able to fix something, it is always a good idea to understand first how it should work. The simplest way to bring some voltage down to the required level is to use so-called linear voltage regulator. One of the most prominent examples is the LM7805. It was, for example, used on many sound cards and other hardware. This chip has three legs, input, output and ground. It simply takes any input voltage above 7 volts and converts it into the stable 5 volts on the output. Similar chips exist for 3.3 volts and other voltages as well. The problem with such a linear voltage regulators is that they are extremely inefficient, because they dissipate all the superfluous power as heat to the environment, especially when a lot of current flows through them. The CPUs are usually very power-hungry devices and need a lot of current, which puts such a linear voltage regulator to its limits. So, for a power-hungry load like a CPU, a simple linear voltage regulator would need a big heatsink and would still be only able to deliver very limited amount of current. Therefore, another clever solution was made to improve the efficiency. The whole regulator circuitry is made of a DC-DC controller and a big power transistor. The DC-DC controller has so-called feedback connection, which measures the output voltage on the transistor and controls the voltage on its base. If the voltage drops too low, the DC-DC converter opens the power transistor a little bit more to raise the voltage again. If the voltage gets too high, the DC-DC converter lowers the base voltage and closes the transistor a little bit to get its output voltage down. The output voltage of such a regulated circuit is a bit wavy. That's why usually a big capacitor is installed on the output, which acts like a low-pass filter and flattens the line. The DC-DC controller will be usually equipped with various resistors, which would define the required output voltage of the whole circuit. And which resistors are needed and other information can be found in the datasheet for the particular DC-DC controller. Please keep in mind that this whole visualization is very inaccurate, simplified and exaggerated. It serves only for explanation purpose and is not a precise model. The benefit of such a circuit is that a lot more current can be sent through it than through a simple linear voltage regulator. It is more efficient and therefore you need significantly smaller head spreader as well. Okay, after a short trip into the theory, now back to the reality. So let's take a closer look at our mainboard again. These jumpers activate the voltage regulator circuit, which is located left from it. It contains this bigger transistor, which is mounted on a small heatsink. As I told, it doesn't get as hot as a simple linear voltage regulator would, but still can get quite warm. Left from it is the mentioned low-pass capacitor, which tries to flatten the output voltage of the regulator, and down here, this IC is the DC-DC controller. Left from it, you can see some resistors and jumpers, which can be used to configure the controller for the required voltage. The voltage regulator circuit is an error-prone component and the wrong CPU voltage on this mainboard is for sure due to failing of one of these components. If they fail, they usually get shorted. So let's start with the transistor. This is the datasheet of the transistor used here. Base is left, collector is in the middle and emitter is on the right. It is a PNP transistor. So if there is no voltage on the base, the transistor is opened and the current flows from the emitter to the collector. If the DC-DC controller puts some voltage onto the base, the transistor gets closed and no current will flow. And as you probably can hear, there is a short between the base and the collector pins of the transistor. I will have to get it out of the board to tell if the transistor is shorted or something on the board. So, I desoldered the transistor. Let's see what we have here. Yep, definitely a short between the base and the collector. And between the collector and emitter, everything is fine. Let me check the mainboard once again. The short has gone indeed. So, I searched for a replacement, but I didn't find the same D45H2A transistor, but I went through some datasheets and found a replacement which should work just as good. It is going to be 2N6491G. Also a PNP power transistor with the same pinout and even slightly better specs than the original. Here you can see that the tester says that the old transistor is just a resistor, what is obviously wrong. Here how it should look like when testing a working transistor which I ordered. As a side note, the transistor could get shorted because the DC-DC converter failed and overloaded it. On the other hand, it could also go into opposite direction and the DC-DC converter could get damaged as the transistor got shorted. So you always have to keep in mind that these both parts not only work hand in hand, but also often fail simultaneously. Not always, but still you should keep an eye on both parts. Just in case, I also ordered some replacement DC-DC converter ICs of the same type. Okay, let's check the voltage. The voltage seems to be stable now, but it remains at around 2.4 volts. That's odd, but I think I should check the jumpers. So the jumpers were not quite right indeed. Both jumpers JPW1 and 2 were set, but only one jumper should be set at a time for a proper selection. For 3.3 volts, the JPW1 needs to be set and JPW2 unset. This is what I said, let's try it, there should be 3.3 volts now. Yeah, 3.258 volts. I call it close enough, I guess. By the way, I actually don't need the wire to measure the voltage, since the metal cooling notch on the transistor is connected to its output internally as well, so I also can measure the voltage directly on this screw. Let's test the other voltages. I will set the jumpers to 3.45 volts. And there are 3.429 volts, also close enough. Now 3.6 volts is at 3.56 volts. All values seem to be slightly underrated. Okay, and last but not least, 4 volts. And here again it is slightly below at 3.996 volts. Well, good enough if you ask me. Well, time for the real test. Now I finally should be able to use this 3 volts AMD486DX280 in this mainboard. The voltage is set to 3.3 volts already, but I still have to set a jumper to force 2x multiplier, or this CPU will run with 3x instead and will be overclocked. Furthermore, I have to set the front side bus to 40 MHz. I inserted an ATI 3D-Rage PCI graphics card and will add a compact flash to IDE adapter with a 512 MB compact flash card in it, where I have DOS pre-installed together with all the benchmarks, games and tools I might need. And we have a signal. Here it says 486DX2 at 80 MHz, looks right to me. Let's once again measure the voltage. Yeah, stable 3.256 volts. I will have to make some stress tests, but so far it looks promising. I ran the Doom benchmark now 3x and didn't have any stability issues so far. Interesting is that the CPU doesn't get even warm. A DX266 at 5 volts gets quite hot after running the Doom benchmark, but this AMD CPU at 3.3 volts got only to 26 degrees Celsius. As I said, Doom benchmark already ran 3x, and you currently can see it, but it is running again and the CPU is just cold. That's funny. Well, and for today, this was what I wanted to show you. A voltage regulator circuit is a very common issue on many, many devices, and not only on the retro hardware. At this point, I would like to thank Marek, one of my patrons, for the important feedback and corrections for this video. And I hope that I could share some useful information about how it works and how to approach in such cases. And if it was nothing new to you, still, I just hope you enjoyed this repair and had some good time watching this video. So far, see you next time, thank you and goodbye.